Good evening. I want to greet you on this beautiful Tuesday or Thursday afternoon, Thursday evening. This is New Creation's Reality, and today is lesson number 2. I believe this is going to be a very exciting class. In fact, I enjoyed myself immensely this past Tuesday when we introduced the class. And even though that I suppose that I have quoted scriptures all my life or all my Christian life concerning the new creation, the new man that we are, that it has only been in recent years that I've come to grips with the full reality of what it means to be a new creation. And that's what we're going to be talking about in this class. Last week we spent a great deal of time laying the foundation and perhaps giving an overview for the course, and we did not get into a great deal of the syllabus. In fact, according to the syllabus, we only got through the first section, realizing who we are in Christ. And of course, that's very, very important. And we're going to take a look at the two creations of God, meaning the creation of the first Adam, and then, of course, the creation of the last Adam. And hopefully, we will continue to build on the foundation to give you a clearer understanding as to what God is seeking to communicate to us. It's so important for us to know who we are in Christ Jesus. We have plenty of training to know who we are in Adam, because that is what we've been programmed with all of our lives. That's all we've ever heard, has been how evil, how unrighteous we are, or how unworthy that we are. And I am not denying the reality of evil. I'm not denying the reality of wickedness and ungodliness and sin. We're not denying the reality of the devil. All of those things are certain realities. But we need to come to realize that in Christ Jesus, we are new creations, and those things that we have held on to so dearly and that we have made almost sacred cows out of have kept us in bondage. It has kept us under the oppressive hand of the enemy. And therefore, we have not been able to walk in the full liberty of the sons of God. We have not understood the blessings of the Lord which belong to us because of perhaps self-condemnation or the condemnation of others. We have listened to condemning preachers, I guess, all of our lives, and that has seemed to have been what we thought was the gospel, but that's really not the gospel. Now, I understand the matter of preaching against the evils of the world, preaching against sin, and bringing people to repentance, bringing people to the knowledge of the saving grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. But after we have received the blessings of the grace of Jesus, and we have certainly experience the love and the mercy of God, the forgiveness of our sins, not just the forgiveness of our sins, but the remission of our sins, and we have received the recreated, or our spirit has been recreated, and we have received the very life and the nature of God the Father into our very being. And so I believe that instead of having so much death and condemnation and sin consciousness, the believers need to be taught who they are in Christ Jesus. It's so very important for us to be able to carry the proper identity, for us to know who we are. It was a struggle for Jesus in his earthly walk to come to realize who he was. Now, I understand that in the beginning was a Word, the Word was with God, the Word was God, the same was in the beginning with God. And this Word made flesh came, dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as the only begotten Son of God, full of grace and truth. Jesus was truly God in the flesh, But we have to understand that Jesus also himself was flesh. He was a partaker of flesh and blood. He became a man in order that he might accomplish the plan of redemption. As we will see in the lesson in just a few moments, that Adam and Eve walked in perfect fellowship with God. And because of the original sin of disobedience, man took upon himself the nature of Satan and lost all contact and all fellowship with God. And so it was necessary in the plan of redemption for man to defeat Satan, because it was Satan who deceived man and caused man to fall. Therefore, Jesus had to come and to be made manifest in the flesh in order that he might win the total victory over the kingdom of darkness. And that could not have been accomplished by any other than he who was never under the dominion of this satanic kingdom, who had never been a partaker of the nature of the first Adam, and Jesus is the only one who could qualify. But Jesus, as a man, came and experienced the same things that you and I, he felt the same feelings, he experienced every human emotion, and that way he identified with man. And I believe it also tells us that if Jesus, the man Jesus, was able to overcome the evil one, then we can also overcome. If Jesus was able to face temptation without sin, and because we have received the nature of the Father, we should also be able to reject temptations of the flesh and to be able to walk as sons of light, sons and daughters of light in this present world. But the scripture says that Jesus emptied himself, or the scripture actually says that he took upon himself, he fashioned himself after man, took upon himself the form of man. He became obedient even to the death of the cross. And as a result, God then highly exalted him and gave him a name that's above every name that is in heaven or earth or under the earth. And of course, we know that Jesus was pre-existent with God the Father in the beginning, in creation, before the creation of all things. And we certainly know that Jesus was the Lamb prepared before the foundation of the earth to come to be the sacrificial lamb that would take away the sins of the whole world. But in order for him to take on form of a man, and for him to empty himself, in a sense we could think of him as emptying himself of deity. Now, there is a lot of differing opinions as to whether Jesus was all God and all man, or whether he was part God, or whether he was part man. Well, the truth is that Jesus has eternally been God. He's always been God. But in a sense, when he took upon himself the form of a man, that he really had no remembrance. And this is all part of the plan and the program of God. Now, we think about Jesus having all knowledge. Jesus, as God, had all knowledge, and yet we realize that he was limited as a man when he walked on this earth. The Bible says that he grew in wisdom. He grew in stature, both with God and with man. He went through the growing up process, being subject to an earthly father and an earthly mother. He was taught. He was tutored. And then, of course, a time came that he was presented to the world as God's only begotten Son. And he said, "This is my beloved Son, hear ye him." But in the meantime, really, Jesus had to come to full knowledge and full realization as to who he really was. And there's so many scriptures that backs this up. I see basically three major times in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ on this earth where he was faced with temptation. Now, the only time that we have the word temptation associated with Jesus was when he was in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights being tempted of the devil. And then the scripture says that after Jesus had won the victory and he had said, it is written, Satan left him for a season. And I often thought about that. I thought, well, does that mean that Jesus maybe had another encounter? Well, to tell you the truth, he had at least two encounters on this earth, and he had a final encounter in the very gates of hell when he went into the lower parts of the earth after he had been crucified, and he literally took hold of the keys of death and hell, conquering Satan on his own grounds and forever defeating him and bringing liberty and salvation to every man who would trust and believe in him. So I often thought about the scripture that says that Satan departed from him and left him for a season. And, you know, I'm thinking, now what scripture shows us of any indication that Jesus ever, quote, had an encounter with the devil? I don't think he ever had, again, another face-to-face encounter with the devil until he went into the lower parts of the earth, in the hell itself. But he certainly experienced what I believe to be an encounter with the spirit of Satan. And one was, of course, when Jesus said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. So let's think about this just for a moment. We know that Jesus had all power. God the Father had given him all power in heaven and in earth. He demonstrated the power of God in this earth through his ministry. And yet, we know that Jesus as a man was tired in his body, had to withdraw himself from the multitudes. He had to pull himself away to pray, to meditate. He certainly ate, he hungered. There was a time the disciples said, Lord, aren't you going to eat? And Jesus said, well, I have meat to eat of that you know not of, and my meat is to do the will of the Father. But we know that Jesus ate, he slept, he experienced all the things that we experience. But the two times that I believe that Jesus really had an encounter with anything that we could consider to be temptation would be when Peter confronted him and then when he was in the garden. Now, both times, I believe the issue was over something within the human nature of Jesus really did not want to go to the cross. And yet he knew that it was necessary. Jesus knew that this was a reason that God the Father sent him to this earth. Many reasons. He certainly came to set us an example, to teach us the precepts and the concepts of the kingdom of God. He certainly came to set an example for us. He came to seek and to save those who were lost. And we know that he came to fulfill all the law. He came to die, and he was called to finish the work of redemption by going into the lower parts of the earth and then, of course, ascending into heaven. And I believe that what Jesus did as our high priest was to take his own blood into the heavenly holy of holies, into the mercy seat to be applied once and for all, to never to have to be another sacrifice, not another blood sacrifice. So Jesus had his purpose in this earth. And his purpose was to die. His purpose was to go to the cross. And Jesus knew that. He came to the full realization of that. And he spent 3.5 years on this earth seeking to convince his disciples that this was needed. But, you know, the sad thing is that his disciples did not really understand what Jesus was talking about even up until the final week of his life on this earth. They still were blinded when Jesus would say, destroy this temple and I'll raise it up in 3 days. When he said the only sign that will be given will be the prophet Jonah, as Jonah was in the belly of the whale 3 days and 3 nights, so shall the Son of God or Son of Man be in the belly of the earth for 3 days and three nights. And there's something that just now occurs to me. Well, I'll have to think about that. And it's really over the question as to if Jesus actually spent 3 days and three nights, you know, especially if you're talking about being crucified on Friday and being raised on the Sabbath, but we won't get, or the first day of the week, we won't get into that discussion, not in this context. But we understand that that was needed. He had to die. His disciples did not understand it. They, like most of the Israelites, didn't really understand the true concept of the Messiah. They did not understand the true nature of the kingdom of God. They did not understand that the kingdom of God cometh not by observation, but the kingdom of God was within. The kingdom of God is marked by love. It's marked by peace and joy and righteousness in the Holy Ghost. The Jewish concept of the Messiah was that there would be a prince who would come and would be crowned king, and that he literally, physically, would take over all of the oppressors of Israel. Well, the truth of the matter is, he not only took over all of the oppressors of Israel, but of all the whole world. He came to liberate the whole world, but not in the sense that the Jews were looking for. They were looking for their earthly kingdom to be exalted once again back to glory, and for all of their oppressors to be smushed or to be crushed down with military might, political power and might. But that was not the nature of the kingdom of God. That was not the nature of Jesus' purpose on this earth. So, really, I believe that the temptation of Satan was to cause Jesus to think in terms, now, is it possible that I can accomplish the will of the Father without going to the cross? Now, we know that ultimately, because Jesus went to the cross, that we're going to be rulers and we're going to reign with him as kings and priests on this earth. And so, you know, whatever Satan had to offer, if he had anything to offer, if he had a kingdom to offer Jesus, and I guess all he really had to offer Jesus was maybe rulership over the world system and the government of men and the way that men thought. But Jesus had no desire to entertain that thought. And the only way he could really resist it was because he knew the word. And he said that, you know, first of all, it is written that God and God alone is to be served. And of course, when turn these stones into bread, he said, man shall not live by bread alone. Cast yourself down off of the pinnacle of the temple. All of these things were a temptation for him to demonstrate the power that you would think in terms of being associated with the Messiah. In other words, the true Messiah ought to be like Superman. He ought to be able to cast himself down off of the pinnacle of the temple and be no harm. Or that he could just say zap, you know, and turn the stones into bread. And Jesus would certainly have that ability. If he could multiply the fish and the loaves, he could certainly speak to a rock and for it to be made bread. But it was a temptation for Jesus really to get ahead of the plan of God and to demonstrate a power which would be glorifying to himself. And so he realized that his only purpose was to come to do the will of the Father, and it was not to bring any glory to himself. So that was the first temptation, and Jesus overcame with flying colors. And then we come to the time that Jesus said, I must go and I must die. And Peter said, Lord, forbid it to be so. In other words, don't even talk like that. That there's no way that that is in the plan of God. See, he had still never heard. He had never understood the teaching that Jesus was trying to get across to them, that he would die, but he would be raised from the dead. And so Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God." In other words, you don't understand spiritual things. You don't understand the nature of the kingdom of God. And it's understandable. Peter was not born again. Peter was not a recreated spirit. He had not experienced the new birth. He had not become a new creation man, because that was only accomplished after Jesus had completed his mission on this earth and he had gone into the lower parts of the earth and then ascended back to God the Father. Then and only then could we become a new creation in Christ Jesus. And then, of course, the third encounter was in the garden, where Jesus said, "Father, if it be thy will, let this cup pass from me." The cup that he was to drink to him was a bitter cup. And it was a bitter cup of suffering and of death. And so the human part of Jesus would be just as you and I. We would not want to suffer any pain in our flesh, but the scripture says that we're to put on the same mind that as Jesus suffered in the flesh, he overcame. And of course, it was his suffering that we are able to overcome. And there are still sufferings for us, not physical sufferings, or not suffering cancer and all these things that people have fed us with garbage and said that it was the will of God and that was our way in obtaining unto glory. But the suffering that we're going to suffer is the continual warfare between the flesh and the spirit, where we have the awareness that it's an awareness that there is this constant warfare. But if we could come to realize through the finished work of Christ that the warfare is really over. But it's a painful thing when we're trying to live a dual life, when we're still trying to walk in the flesh and walk in the spirit, and we're in the midst of this conflict. It's a painful thing maybe to suffer persecution or to suffer afflictions, which would be a type of persecution. But Jesus, as a man, said, "Father, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." And then again, the encounter that he had with Satan in the belly of the earth. Well, what I want to do is to, everything I've shared with you so far is the truth. It's the Word of God. And hopefully it still gives us a picture that what I shared with you gives us a clear picture as to what the new creation is. But in order for us to understand completely the need for a new creation man, let's go all the way back to the beginning. Let's go back to the beginning of creation. We know the creation story, how that God in 6 days of creation, which personally I do not believe are 6 24-hour days, because a 24-hour day is determined by the rotation of the earth in connection with the sun, and the sun wasn't even created till the fourth day, so that's another discussion. But we know that in 6 days of creation that God created all things. Now, here is the important point, that God created everything that he created in the first 5 days of creation for his crowning glory, and that was man. The final phase of the creation of God was a creation of man in his own likeness and his own image. But the first 5 days were the phases of creation that prepared everything with man in mind. God created this earth for man. God created all of the vegetation, the water, and the fruit of the land for man. Earth was man's domain, or earth was man's, what can we say? It was man's, domain, dominion. It was man's home, and God put man in charge. I don't want to get too far ahead of myself. Let's create man before we give man a charge, or to say what God's purpose was for man. This is so exciting to me. I just really appreciate the word of the Lord. I appreciate the word of God that is more than some intellectual pursuit. It's more than giving mental assent to. It's a living word of God that quickens us, that causes us to see clearly the will and the mind of God. But God created man in his own likeness, in his own image. And I believe the reason why God created man is that he wanted someone of his kind that he could fellowship with. And no one could truly fellowship with God the Father unless they would be of the same substance as God. So God created man in his likeness and in his image. So let's take a look at that. Let's take a look at that concept and see exactly what God was speaking about, what God meant when he said that he created man in his likeness and his image. Now, you know, of course, our carnal way of thinking and looking from a natural point of view, we think in terms of being created in someone's likeness and image is to have, you know, the same body build or the same color of hair, color of eyes, or same complexion, or the same brain cells. And according to, you know, the human side of things, that when we as human beings produce another human being through procreation, we pass on our genes, which means that the color of the eyes or sometimes even temperament can be passed on through the genes. But when we were created in the likeness and the image of God, that's not even to insinuate that God looks like you or me. It doesn't insinuate that God is 6'2 and, you know, a trim 190 pounds or as some people would say that God is some female. You know, that's really, to me, that's really irrelevant, trying to make God male or female. God's everything. You know, God is male and female. God created Adam. Male and female created he them. But when God created man in his own likeness and his own image, the first thing that we have to understand is what is the substance of God? The substance of God is spirit. God is spirit. Now, does that mean that God has form? Does a spirit have form? Well, perhaps. Does the spirit have a body? Well, the Bible does talk about a spiritual body, but in the sense that as we think in terms of this earth walk, a spirit has to embody or has to come and indwell a body. That's really the only way that any spirit can have any existence in this world. Now, we may think about, you know, a spirit floating around out in the atmosphere, or we could think in terms of some eerie, spooky thing, but no one can have influence in this earth except you have a body. God's influence in the earth is through a body. First of all, this body right here is the temple of the Holy Ghost. This is the dwelling place of the Holy Ghost. But in the bigger picture, the body of Christ is the dwelling place or the temple of the Holy Ghost and is the manifestation of God in the earth. Okay, so God is spirit, but God sought for an embodiment of himself to live in this earthly environment. He creates us in His likeness and His image, which first of all tells me that I'm spirit. Now you look at me, and if you knew me 20 years ago, you would know that I looked a little younger. I had, 20 years ago, probably didn't have any gray hair at all. Had no wrinkles. You know, there was a lot, there's a great contrast between the way you view me today in comparison to 20 years ago. But when you look at me and you think that you see me, you think that you know me, all you're doing is observing this outer shell. This outer shell is not the real me. This outer shell just simply gives an encasement or a dwelling place for the true me, and that is the spirit. And the Bible identifies this as the inner man. It identifies this as being the inner spirit, or the hidden man of the spirit. So when you look at me, you see me in a particular shape, form, and you may never really know me. You know, the old saying is, to know me is to love me. And you hear people say, well, I've lived with you for 30 years and I still don't know you. And that's true. Paul said there was a time that, first of all, he said, know no man after the flesh, but after the spirit. There was a time that I observed men by the flesh and knew them by the flesh. He said there was even a time that I saw Jesus, or I perceived Jesus as being in the flesh. And all of our attention that's on a fleshly Jesus is really missing the reality of the fact that what is more important than to see Jesus appear here in some physical form is to realize that there is a spirit world and there's a spirit realm that I can know spiritual things and understand spiritual things and to know who He really is. Now, somebody says, well, you know, if Jesus appeared just really showed up, I would believe. Well, would you? They didn't 2,000 years ago. If Jesus happened to show up, if you don't have the right perception, if you don't have a spiritual insight, if something showed up, you would shake your head and think, well, am I seeing an illusion? Am I hallucinating? Is this really real? And so for me to really to know the presence of Christ, whether it be in the flesh or out of the flesh, you're going to have to be by the Spirit. And so God created us in His likeness and His image. He created us a spirit. The Bible says that God created man out of the dust of the earth. He shaped him. He formed him. He created a shell out of the dust of the earth. And of course, you know, the dust we came from, dust we shall return, if you go by the way of the grave. And then the scripture says that God breathed into man. God literally took His breath. He took the breath of life, the very life of the Spirit, and breathed into this empty shell, and man became a living soul. The body was created from the earth. God breathed into man His life, His very breath, and then man became a living soul. Meaning that man took on a personality. He took on a means by which that you could relate to the outside world. And so when we think about being made in the likeness and the image of God, first of all, we're spirit. Now, another way that I look at being made in the likeness and the image of God is that as man is triune, or we could say man is a tripartite. Man is three-dimensional. Again, man is a spirit. He lives in a body and he has a soul. Now, we understand I say we understand, we know the teaching, or we know the terminology of the triunity of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I don't think that very many people really understand even the true concept of you know, God being Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but we won't even attempt to go there. But I believe that the Father is really associated with the Spirit, the Son is associated with the body, and the Holy Spirit is really associated with the soul. Because God the Father is the Spirit. Jesus was the body of God in the earth. It pleased the Father that in Jesus should dwell all the fullness of the Godhead in bodily form, and we're complete in Him. And when you speak about the Holy Spirit being the soul of God, it's only in the sense that it's in the soul that that emotions are experienced. So, you know, the Holy Spirit can be grieved. The Holy Spirit is associated with joy and all kinds of emotions. So in that sense, we could think in terms of God being soul, you know, spirit, soul, body. But the important thing is that God created man of His same substance. He gave man the capability of communicating with Him, with God the Father. God walked with man, namely Adam and Eve, in the cool of the day. Every day, every evening, He took a stroll with Adam and Eve. Man was in perfect fellowship with God, having a perfect union, a perfect relationship. But something happened. God said, we're getting now to the purpose of man. We're getting now to what God's command to man was. God said to Adam to be fruitful, multiply, and replenish the earth, and to have dominion over the earth. So, to be fruitful, to multiply, replenish the earth, and to have dominion over the earth was God's original mandate. This is what we call the dominion mandate. That was man's purpose, was to take dominion over all things. And you know, when you talk about the garden, when you think in terms of the garden, I see so many things now from a different perspective. And I believe it's because that God has allowed me to see through the eyes of the Spirit and to understand the nature of God in His creation from a spiritual point of view, from a spiritual dimension. I don't deny, you can't deny the fact that there was a geographical location where Adam and Eve abided. We can't deny that. And apparently, according to the scripture, it was somewhere between the Tigris and Euphrates River, which is over in Iraq, ironically, Iraq. And I believe that was where Adam and Eve had a home. And of course, history bears out that the early civilization began in that region, probably one of the earliest known civilizations, that's historically speaking. But as far as, you know, the garden being just a little small diminutive replica that had, you know, a few fruit trees and so forth, again, it's you're not doing away with the natural. There could have been all kinds of trees there. But, you know, for God to say that there's a tree out there of the knowledge of good and evil that bears the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. Well, there's no fruit that I think that you can go pick off of a tree that would be representative of that. And so it is a spiritual analogy. You know, same thing is true of the tree of life. Now, of course, we know that Jesus has become the tree of life and that we can live only as we partake of Him, and that we hear the words that He speaks. And He said, the words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. But God gave clear parameters for Adam and Eve. And He said, that there is one thing that you are forbidden to do, and that is to partake of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. You can partake of all the other trees or of all the other fruit in the garden, including the tree of life. Now, if Adam had chosen to partake of the tree of life, he would have lived forever. And this is exciting because there is a tree of life that we eat of, that we live forever, that we are an eternal being. But you know the story, how that Satan came and deceived Eve, and Adam went along with Eve. They ate of the forbidden fruit. Now, keep in mind what God said to Adam and Eve. He said, "In the day that you eat of this fruit, ye shall surely die." In the day that you eat of this fruit, ye shall surely die. Well, Adam and Eve lived to be 900, I think Adam either lived to be 930 or 950 years old. And Eve, lived for several hundreds more years. And so what is this that God says, in the day that you eat of this fruit, you shall surely die? How is it possible that they could eat of this fruit and still live for 900 more years or so? Well, we have to understand what death is. Death is separation, is a separation. Spiritual death is separation from God, being alienated from the very life of God, walking in darkness, being alienated in darkness from the light. And of course, physical death is a separation of the spirit from the body. In other words, when the spirit is sucked out of the body, then man no longer ceases to be. The body goes back to the earth and disintegrates. And so when we think about death, we talk about physical death. It's the separation of the spirit from the body. And then, of course, the Bible says that the body returns to the dust of the earth and the spirit returns back to God from whence it came. But spiritual death is separation from God, alienation from God, having no contact, not having any ability to associate with God, to fellowship with God, to communicate with God. And that's really exactly precisely what happened. In the day that they ate of the forbidden fruit, they were alienated from God. They experienced spiritual death. And the Bible says that we have once been alienated from the life of God, and we have been separated, dead in our trespasses and in our sins. But we are now quickened, made alive, and made to sit with Him in heavenly places. So that's really the story of the new creation, man being restored back to fellowship with God. But spiritual death occurred on the day that they ate of the forbidden fruit. Now, there was never again the ability to regain that relationship with God, to have fellowship and communion with God, until man's spirit was quickened, made alive, and was literally recreated. Now, keep in mind that man, whether he be a regenerated individual or an unregenerated individual, is a spirit. If you've never been born again, you are a spirit. Because when Adam sinned, he was literally born again, because he took on a different nature. He took on a different life. He took on the life of Satan. He took on the nature of Satan. And so it was necessary for man's spirit to be recreated or to be made anew. Now, there's so many wonderful things that we can talk about concerning the new creation man and the inner man of the heart. But keep this in mind, that being born again literally means our spirit is reborn, our spirit is recreated, our spirit is made anew, that we may still look the same. I mean, you know, if you're bald-headed before you get saved, you're probably still going to be bald-headed after you get saved. Or if you're, unless you go on a diet, if you're fat before you get saved, you'll probably still be fat after you get saved. But there's something that takes place there is a born-again experience that you become a brand new creation, and that new creation is a new spirit. Now, granted that the spirit is to have control or dominion over every other dimension of our lives. Unfortunately, there are those of us who are born again, we have a recreated spirit, but we still have a mind that has to be renewed, and we still have a body that is subject to decay. And so we understand there has to be a redemption of the mind, there has to be a redemption of the body. And this is what we mean by a threefold redemption, or we could speak about a threefold salvation. Salvation is spirit, soul, and body. I'd like to share a scripture with you. The first scripture is in 1 Thessalonians 5:23. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Paul says, "And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God, your whole spirit." Now, go back up here where he says, "The very God of peace sanctify you wholly." That is wholly. That means completely. That means in every aspect of your being. And of course, the nature of God is holiness. The nature of God is righteousness. And the whole point here is to be sanctified wholly. And I pray God, your wholly spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So first of all, the first thing that we want to see here is that this is certainly a scriptural reference to the triunity of man. And God's desire is that we be made whole in every aspect of our being, spirit, soul, and body. To be preserved blameless means that there has to be a change. There has to be a salvation. There has to be a redemption of every aspect of our being. Now, let's take a look now at 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And let's begin reading in verse number 10. 2 Corinthians 1:10. Now, of course, this is speaking about God. You have to, I guess, go back and pick up the context here. That God, through Jesus Christ, has delivered us from so great a debt. Now, what are we talking about? We're talking about new creation realities, aren't we? And what we've been talking about thus far has been the condition of the first created Adam and the need for there to be a resurrection from that state of spiritual death, to be made alive, to be quickened, be resurrected, to literally to be resurrected. Now, we will, in our course of study, we're going to be looking at the resurrection, and we're going to discover that, of course, the resurrection, as we think of in terms of the Bible, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ was a resurrection of his physical body, but that was only one aspect of it. I know this gets really deep in a sense, but I think it's so necessary for us to appreciate the new creation that we are in Christ Jesus. Because in essence, when Jesus became sin for us, when he took upon himself our nature and he took upon himself the sins of the whole world, the Bible says that he who knew no sin became sin, literally became sin, in order that we might become the righteousness of God. So if he became sin, he took on all of the sins of the world upon himself, And God, being a just God, had to literally turn his back on sin. Every demand of justice had to be made. God, being a just God, said that man had to pay the penalty. Man. But the whole key is in the substitutionary death of the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, we'll take I think probably toward the end of the course, we're going to be looking at the substitutionary work of the Lord Jesus Christ and even the whole concept of identification. And it's not that Jesus died for me, but it's that he died as me, and it was literally you and I who hung on the cross with him, that we were crucified with him. He did not just die for us, he died as us, and we literally died. And so many great things that we need to understand concerning the death of the old man and the resurrection into a newness of life. We're always resurrecting the old man, but the resurrection that is really important is that we have been resurrected out of death into life. But anyway, when Jesus took upon the sins of the whole world, he really, at one point in time, was apparently forsaken by God the Father. Jesus had enough contact, enough relationship with God the Father. He was so much one with God the Father, even in his earthly walk. I can assure you that he understood what it meant to be separated. And if he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He literally knew that for a season, whether it be a moment of time or whether it be a period of 3 days and three nights, that there was an alienation until the full price was paid that satisfied the demands of justice. God is a just God. And so Jesus, being separated from God, feeling forsaken, insinuates or indicates that Jesus partook of spiritual death as man had partaken of spiritual death. I want you to follow me here. I know that there are people who have literally crucified E.W. Kenyon, and anyone who's ever read anything after E.W. Kenyon as being a heretic and a blasphemer for even suggesting that Jesus died a spiritual death. But you have to understand the whole plan of redemption. You have to understand that Jesus had to partake of everything that man had partaken of, including spiritual death. Now, the significance of the resurrection is not so much that he came up out of the grave as a physical body, but it indicates that he was raised up and his spirit was resurrected, and Jesus literally, as the man Jesus who died, was raised up, was elevated, his spirit was recreated, and we can say in a sense that he became born again. Well, if he's the firstborn among many brethren, and if he is the first of a new creation, I'm a new creation, you're a new creation, Jesus was the first of a new creation. I'm a new creation because I'm born again. You're a new creation because you're born again. Jesus is the beginning of the new creation because he was literally reborn. I know you probably never heard that before in your life, because I can assure you I didn't have anybody to preach this to me when I was growing up. But when you understand the whole purpose of Jesus coming and identifying with man, and suffering not only physical death but spiritual death, and not only to be raised up out of a grave but to literally be raised up into the newness of life and being declared righteous. Jesus had to be declared righteous. You know why? Because he had taken the sins of the world upon himself, and therefore he had to be declared righteous. He had to regain right standing with God. Now, it's difficult to understand this if you think in terms of Jesus, the man, as being 100% God. And again, you read church history and you find out that there were heretics of the Catholic Church who were excommunicated for even suggesting anything along the lines that, Jesus was human in the sense that he had to become sin and that he had to be declared righteous. He who knew no sin became sin in order that we might become the righteousness of God. Now, how can you become the righteousness of God until Jesus was declared righteous? And how could Jesus be declared righteous until he did take upon himself the sins of the world? Okay? So he was raised up into the newness of life. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust that he will yet deliver us. Now, the word deliver comes from the word, salvation. When we think in terms of salvation in our traditional way of thinking about salvation, in other words, if you have a revival and if folks get saved, we basically say, well, you know, we had five souls that were saved. Well, the truth is, technically speaking, you had five spirits that were saved, five spirits that were reborn, five spirits that were recreated. The truth of the matter is, our soul is being saved, and there is yet a salvation to come. So salvation means deliverance. And if you're talking about salvation, you're talking about salvation in spirit, soul, and body. Salvation or deliverance includes every aspect of man. You cannot separate, say, divine healing from salvation or redemption from our sins, because it's all really a part of God restoring everything that had been lost in the fall. Everything that had been lost in the fall was restored through the Lord Jesus Christ. So if sickness and disease and death came upon men as a result of the first Adam, then the last Adam, not the second Adam, but the last Adam, had to make a provision that your spirit would be reborn or saved. There had to be a provision for your soul to be renewed or saved, meaning the renewing of your man. And there had to be a redemption of the body, meaning that there had to be a reversal of the death sentence that was placed upon us physically. In other words, when we sin, when man sinned, he became subject to physical death. He became mortal. He became corruptible. But the scripture teaches us that there is going to be a change, a final change, wherein that corruptible shall take on incorruption and mortal shall take on immortality. Mortality takes on immortality, right? We all understand that. So we look here at this scripture and it says, who delivered us from so great a death, that is speaking past tense. See, he who delivered us, past tense, from so great a death, spiritual death, and doth deliver, meaning presently, in the now, and that is deliverance in the soul realm, the will, the mind, and the emotions, in particular the mind, in whom we trust that he will yet deliver us. So here we have past deliverance, present deliverance, future deliverance. It all just ties in together. It just fits beautifully, doesn't it? When you see the progressive plan of God, that first there is the redemption, the recreation of the spirit that has been alienated from God, and then there is the deliverance from all of the wrong thinking, what we have been programmed with. And that is a colossal job. I can assure you that that is a colossal task that God has called the body of Christ, the church, the ministers in the body of Christ, to literally preach the gospel, the true gospel that will bring about a transformation in the way we think. That's the reason why it's so difficult sometimes for people who are brought up in church, born in church, and heard the gospel, what they call the gospel all their lives, but they've really been programmed. They've been programmed with wrong teaching, with wrong theology. And so that becomes a hindrance. That becomes a stumbling block that keeps people from really walking in the full reality of who they are in Christ Jesus, because so many things have to be unlearned or untaught. But thanks be unto God, there is a preaching of the true gospel that is liberating and transforming our minds. Our minds are being renewed. Romans chapter 12 says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so the only way, first of all, if your mind is not renewed, if you still think the same way the world does, you're conformed to the world. In fact, being conformed to the world means that you really think the way the world does. You solve problems the way the world solves problems. You approach everything from a natural point of view. But when you understand that we are not to be conformed to this world, we're not to think as this world, there's going to have to be a change, there's going to have to be a transformation, the renewing of our minds. So this is the threefold salvation that had been brought as a result of the atoning work of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we have looked at the composition of man's spirit, soul, and body. We have talked about the lost ascendancy, how that we have fallen from a high and lofty place, but we have now been exalted with Him, and we're made to sit with Him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And Ephesians chapter 1 says that these heavenly places are far above principalities and powers and all of the things of this earth realm. If you want to know where heavenly places are, it's having dominion over all of the senses of this natural fleshly man. See, when man fell, the only way that he could gain any knowledge was through his brain power or through his senses. And then, of course, we understand that really there are two kinds of knowledge. There's sense knowledge, and then there's revelation knowledge. Sense knowledge is what is gained through your senses, what you learn through what you see, what you feel, what you touch, what you hear, what you smell. That is the only way that man could relate. But now we have been delivered. We have been elevated out of the beggarly elements of this world, and we have been made to sit with Him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So, this gives us the basis by which that we can accept the scripture that says that if any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creation. Behold, all things are passed, old things are passed away, and all things are become new. The new creation man has literally become the righteousness of God. Now, as a result of Jesus being obedient to the will of the Father and having taken on the sins of the world and been declared righteous, He now has become our righteousness. I believe it's 1 Corinthians 1 and 30, that He has been made unto us righteousness. He has been made unto us wisdom. He has been made unto us sanctification. So when you speak about righteousness, are you talking about your own righteousness? No, there's none righteous, no, not one. There's not a one that is righteous outside of the righteousness of God. Otherwise, it would be self-righteousness. You can't save yourself. You can't cause yourself to be reborn again. Nicodemus said, "Do I enter back into my mother's womb?" He just totally misunderstood the whole concept and the dimension of spiritual rebirth. And then, of course, Jesus said that that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. And then the scripture teaches us, and I believe I have this written down here, 1 Corinthians 15:45-49. This is kind of reinforce what we've already stated concerning the first creation. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. Now keep in mind that God created man out of the dust of the earth. He breathed into him and man became what? A living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. The first Adam, a living soul. The last Adam, a quickening spirit. Howbeit, that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. See, these are the two creations of God. These are the... Let me be very clear and precise in my terminology here. First of all, let's make it very, very clear that Jesus was not the second Adam. I'm supposing the second Adam was probably Cain and Abel, and Noah was maybe the 50th Adam, and you maybe the 10,000th or 100,000th or millionth Adam before the cross. I'm not Adam any longer. I'm not identified with Adam. I'm identified with Christ. I'm not identified with the first Adam, but with the last Adam. And the last Adam meant that Jesus literally brought an end to a race, an old creation. He brought an end. He fulfilled all of the law. He fulfilled all of the demands of justice. But as a result of bringing that old creation to an end, he was the progenitor or the beginning of a new creation. And so that is what the scripture means when he says, the scripture says that he's the firstborn among many brethren. The scripture teaches us that there was a time that God identified Jesus as being the only begotten Son of God. Now keep in mind that before the plan of redemption was completed, before the new creation was possible, Jesus was the only begotten Son. But guess what? As a result of his fulfilling the will and the purpose of God in this earth, making a way for a new creation man, and giving us the ability to be reconciled back to God, and being able to regain our fellowship, our relationship, first of all, our relationship, and then our fellowship with God as sons of God. See, we're not heirs. We're not servants, but we are heirs of God, joint heirs of Jesus Christ. We are, according to Hebrews, that we are even brethren. We are co-laborers with the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the firstborn among many brethren. And as the body has many members, so is the body of Christ. A corn of wheat that falls into the ground and dies bring forth many. So Jesus was the first, but we are the many that follow. And that's a result of being reconciled back to God the Father. So keep in mind that Jesus was not the second Adam, he was the last Adam, but he was the first among many brethren are recreated new creation beings. The first man is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy. In other words, as we have taken on the image of the first Adam, we shall also take on the image of the first of the new creation, or the last Adam who became the first of a new creation. Jesus was the last Adam only until he completed the work of redemption. And then our identity is not in Adam. We are not of the same race. We don't have the same nature. We don't have the same blood. We are not alienated from God. The scripture even teaches us that once we, speaking about the Gentiles, once they were alienated, or they were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, are now made nigh by the blood of Jesus Christ, and every middle wall of partition has been broken down, and that which once was twain, or two, divided, has become one new man in Christ Jesus. And in Christ Jesus, there's neither male nor female, there's neither bond nor free, neither Jew nor Greek, and neither male nor female. So in Christ Jesus, we're a totally different breed. I want to say this, and you may hear me say it a few more times, that it's important to know our identity, to be able to identify who we really are. And you take on the identity that has been tagged on you. In other words, if you are programmed, it could be a programming of your parents. Your parents can say you're dumb and stupid, you're ugly, that you'll never amount to anything, and you'll begin to act that out. That becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. And so, if it's not so, if that's not what's really true of you, you perceive it to be what's true of you, and you act accordingly. But when we understand who we are, a new creation in Christ Jesus, when we know that, we will begin to act accordingly. But if we continue to act after the identity that's been tagged on us as being sinners and being unworthy, then we're going to behave ourselves as such. But when we come to the knowledge of the true identity that we are a new creation in Christ Jesus, we're going to also act accordingly. As we have borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Romans 5:14 through 21. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression. In other words, death reigned over those who didn't eat of that forbidden fruit. But because you were born a human being, the fact you were born a human being meant that you were a descendant of Adam. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one, many be dead. Now that means that one man sinned and all of his descendants were sinners. One man was alienated from God and all of his descendants were alienated from God until Jesus came to redeem us and to bring us back into fellowship with God the Father, to be reconciled back to God. And so, if by the fact that you were born of the flesh, you were a partaker of Adam's nature, so if by the offense of one many are dead, much more the grace of God and the gift of grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Isn't that good news? Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound, that as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. So let's bring into summarization of what we have been talking about today and bring a finalization to our lesson for today. Looks like we have about 5 minutes here. I think I have already, if I haven't, I will remind you that of course, I have given you a study guide on the syllabus that I had indicated that In this class, there's going to be a grade on the first 50 questions of the study guide, a grade on the second 50 questions of the second 50 of the study guide, total of 100, and then, of course, the final examination. And I do want to emphasize this because I do recall that this is a question on the test, on the study guide, that conscience is the voice of the spirit, reason is the voice of the mind, and feelings are the voice of our body. All right, let's summarize what God says about the new creation. First of all, we have been made the righteousness of God. Again, he who knew no sin became sin. This is 2 Corinthians 5:21. Some of these scriptures, I think it would do you well. It would be profitable to you. It would be a blessing to you if you just really commit to memory. It just becomes a part of you. And the more you program yourself with the Word of God, the more you're going to be renewed in your mind. Romans 5:1, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace. There's nothing that can compare to peace, nothing that can be a substitute for peace. To have peace with God, to have a sense of having the ability to enter into the presence of God without any sense of guilt or condemnation. That's really what righteous means. To be righteous means that we've been declared righteous, or justification is the declaration that we're righteous. And then righteousness means that we have the ability to stand before God without any sense of guilt or condemnation, that we can come boldly into the presence of God and to know that we have access to Him, that we have access to His presence, and we have communion and fellowship with Him. Colossians 1:13 tells us about being free from the dominion of Satan. Being a new creation man means that we have been liberated from the dominion of Satan's kingdom. Colossians 1:13, for He has rescued us. This is the NIV version. The King James Version says that He hath translated us out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of His Son. NIV, for He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves. Now, Hebrews 2:14, Jesus partook of flesh and blood in order that He might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. So one of the blessings of realizing who you are in Christ and one of the blessings of knowing new creation realities is that Satan has no dominion over us. We've been translated out of his kingdom, that he has no power over the believer. He has only the power that we relegate to him, and any other power that he would have is what he has usurped, the authority that he doesn't really have, but he has taken it. And he will have dominion over you to the degree that you will allow him to have dominion over you. God looks upon us as he would look upon Christ. I used to say as a young boy, Lord, help me to see myself as you see me. And I thought that was an honorable prayer because I thought what God would do would be to show me how filthy and dirty I was. And I guess that I'd be remorseful and would repent. And God spoke to me one day and he says, I am going to show you. I'm going to show you yourself as I see you. And he said, I see you righteous because of my son Jesus. God sees us through the eyes of the blood of Jesus Christ. And if we could understand that, we could truly say that there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And we can also say, who can lay anything against God's elect? For it is God who justifies, and it is God who has made us righteous. Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessing. Thank you for your word. Jesus, we want to thank you for what you did through your obedience. And we just give you the praise, the honor, and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. We'll see you next time.